I received a wonderful question, actually, last night, as to why is it so difficult for people to simply believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? Why do people always want to put on these additions to faith alone, in Christ alone? And the answer is really not that difficult. It's because when one believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, they have to give up all those things that they've held on to for so long. If they were in religion, they have to admit they were wrong, and that the, let's say they're 30 years old, and for 15 of those years, they've been working really hard, as they think, for the Lord, but never believed in Christ. So now all that's out the window. All that work they did, meaningless. And people don't like it when they don't get paid. That's a way to look at it. You work and you work and you work and you work, and then suddenly you realize you're not going to get paid for it, that it's meaningless. Then in fact, it's worse than meaningless. It is, as described in Isaiah 64:6, as filthy rags. So you worked and worked and worked to accumulate filthy rags. It's a hard pill to swallow. That's why many people don't believe. It's arrogance, really. They want to hold on to their good works, their fake smiles, their pretended sweetness. That's what makes it so difficult. Because when you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you have to give up human power. And there are a lot of power-hungry people today, as there always have been. And you don't have the power over your salvation. It is the power of God unto salvation, not our power, not our works, not what you and I can do. All of that, as Isaiah 64:6 says, is filthy rags. So yes, it's difficult for many to believe in Christ because they have to give up power. They have to hand the power over to someone else. Now in Isaiah chapter 1 verse 3, it speaks about an ox. Now an ox is dumb. An ox is a dumb animal. But oftentimes the ox is smarter than many believers who think they can lose their salvation, or many people who think it's just too simple to believe. Why? Well, the ox knows its owner. Do you know your owner? If you've believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, you should know your owner. Your owner is the Lord Jesus Christ. Even the ox knows his owner. Even a donkey, a stubborn donkey, knows its owner's manger. In other words, it knows where it receives sustenance. Then Isaiah goes on to say, but Israel does not know. My people do not understand. That's where we find ourselves as a country and as a collection of people who call ourselves Christians. And at one point you may have simply believed in Christ, but now you want to go straight back to that human power. God's power wasn't enough for you. God's power saved you, not you. You didn't save you. God saved you. The Lord Jesus Christ, who was hanging on the cross between heaven and hell, as it were, and received the imputation of all of your sins, past, present, and future. So, it's simple for you to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so it's simple. Why? How? Because it was made so difficult for our Lord. Our Lord did it for us. Our Lord did all the work. Now for someone who's been working and working for 30 years and realizes it's all been for naught, and they're not even going to get paid for all that work, it's a very hard pill to swallow. Because you have to give all of that, it means nothing. You have to realize it. Well, you don't have to, but you will realize it means nothing. That it was all the power of Jesus Christ, the power of God unto salvation, that he did all the work. And once you believe, that's it. You're in the family of God. You become royal family of God. And there's no way out of that. Why? Because it's not your power that put you into that situation. And your power can't get you out of that situation. You are now royal family of God, period. Romans 8:38 through 40 states, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." When you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are identified with Christ, baptizo in the Greek. And once you're identified with Christ, there's no way out. You're a member of the family, no matter how dumb you are, no matter what type of sins you commit that shock you. I know you're probably thinking of sins that are shocking. Well, there are sins that people commit all the time that they're not shocked about at all. Gossip, for one. I hear Christians gossip all the time. That's an awful sin. Worse than many of the sins that you think of as an abomination. But no matter what sins you are committing, no matter how you are as a human being, it's still the power of God unto salvation. And once you're in the family, you're there. And the Apostle Paul as much says so. For he says, "I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things of the future, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation." And that includes you. Are you creation? Yes. You are creation. That means you cannot cancel God's love for you. And for you to think so is complete and total arrogance. You've decided to go back to the trough the pigs feed from, and you've become dumber than an ox. For even an ox knows his owner. Do you? Now, sometimes I receive some scripture every now and then from people who do not agree because they want to do something. They want to add to it. First of all, you must repent, they say, not knowing what the word repent means in the Greek, which is metanoia, to change your mind. And it was used in the book of Matthew mainly because he was speaking to Jews who had already rejected Christ. Therefore, they needed to change their mind about Christ. Rarely do you see the word metanoia in the book of John, because he's teaching to Gentiles. They didn't need to change their mind because they hadn't heard of Christ. So when John went out, he said, "Believe, believe, believe." They didn't have to change their mind. It was the first time they ever heard anything like what John was teaching. And that's why in John 16:8 through 9, it states, "When the Holy Spirit comes, he will convince the world concerning sin. Concerning sin because they do not believe in me." The sin you're convicted of is the only unforgivable sin, and that is faith, not believing in Christ. And God the Holy Spirit, to be theologically technical, in common grace, makes the gospel understandable to the spiritually dead unbeliever. When you're an unbeliever, you're spiritually dead. You have a body and a soul. You have no human spirit. God the Holy Spirit in common grace acts as your human spirit and communicates to you the gospel so that you can understand it. Now it's up to you. Either I believe in Christ or I do not. And so that's why God the Holy Spirit is convicting you concerning sin. What sin? The sin of unbelief. Many people need scriptural verification, and that's fine. I need it too. I like it. And every now and then I'll receive a verse that's been taken out of context. Romans 10, 9, and 10. Some passages from James. A few other passages that seem to contradict other passages. But the Word of God does not contradict itself. It's impossible. It's the Word of God, and God is not contradictory. And there are far more passages. You see, you pull out a passage that deals with after salvation what, and then you say, aha, this is for salvation. You take the entirety of the Bible and look at it and say, this Bible, all that's written in the Bible is about how to be saved. Wrong. Very little in the Bible is written on how to be saved. Most of what is written in the Bible is, especially in the epistles, how to live your spiritual life as a believer. Salvation's the easy part. And it is simple. Because it was so difficult for our Lord Jesus Christ when he cried out, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? And as all the sins of the world were being imputed to him and judged, God the Father turned his back on God the Son for the first time ever in all of history. It was difficult. That's why it's so simple for us. So the next time you wonder, why is it so hard to just simply believe? Think about the fact that our Lord did all the work for us. And that's hard for some people because they want to do all the work. They want to receive the praise. Well, just as John the Baptizer said, he must increase and I must decrease. The issue is the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have from direct statement of Scripture the means of salvation, and it is believe. Simply believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And you can throw a verse here and there at me that has nothing to do with salvation, but is speaking of something entirely different, usually related to after salvation what? And you'll ignore all of these passages that I'm about to give you. The Word of God doesn't contradict itself. So let's see what the Word of God has to say. John 3:15, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. John 3:16, for God loved the world so much that he gave his uniquely born son, so that whosoever believes in him shall never perish, but have eternal life. And I want you to note the word never. Eternal security. You can't get out of it. Once you believe in Christ, you'll never be separated from God. John 3:18, he who believes in Christ is not judged, but he who does not believe has been judged already because he has not believed in the unique person of the Son of God. And in this verse, the word believe is used three times. Does it say he who invites Christ is not judged? No. Because that makes no sense. And when you invite someone somewhere, that involves you. And when you're spiritually dead, you can't invite anyone anywhere. It's just as if you're physically dead. No dead person is coming up from the grave and asking you as a zombie to come join them at some party. You are spiritually dead. So who does the inviting? Come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus Christ does the inviting. And in John 3:18, the word believe is used three times. Does it say he who believes in him and then confesses with his mouth? No. You say, what about Romans 10, 9 and 10? Romans 10, 9 and 10 deals with technical grammar. Actually, even the way it's written in the English, without even having to go into the Greek, it should be very perspicuous or understandable of the cause and effect relationship. I learned about cause and effect when I was in kindergarten and middle school. And we had to circle what is the cause and what is the effect. Well, when you believe in Christ, and then you go out and confess it with your mouth, that's a cause and effect. First of all, you believe in Christ, you're saved. Now that you're saved, you run out and tell people about it. Well, first of all, the cause of you running around and telling everyone is because you believed in Christ. That's the effect, actually. So John 3:36, and by the way, John 3:18, believe, is mentioned three times, and the Bible doesn't contradict itself. So don't throw other passages at me unless you want to go ahead and believe the Bible contradicts itself. And I also issue this one, before I close here, I issue you a challenge. Find for me one verse in the Bible that says, if you invite Christ into your heart, you'll be saved. Now, don't even give me that, behold, I stand at the door and knock, whosoever enters, etc., because that is a verse dealing with someone who has already believed. This deals with fellowship. Now John 3:36, he who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not believe in the Son does not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. John 6:47, truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me has eternal life. John 11:25, Jesus said to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live, even if he dies. John 11:26, and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. And everyone who lives, now why is that mentioned? Because once you're dead, it's over. No more extra chance. Your chances are over. You have to be alive when you believe, physically alive. That's why our Lord says that you have to believe while you're alive, and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. And why? Well, it's very simple. I receive some people who are ignorant of the word who say, even the demons believe in the Lord and they tremble. Well, guess what? This salvation is not for the demons. And this salvation is not for the dead. This salvation is for the living human beings. Of course the demons tremble. They already made their choice. Now it's time to make yours. So with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, if you haven't made the greatest decision ever to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, then now's your time while you're alive. For everyone who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ shall never die. And these have been written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, for you are all children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. So right now you have the choice, in thought only, inaudibly, to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is the very moment of your salvation. And it is that simple. If you'd like to hear more, you can visit www.aelewisministries.org.